Welcome to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute is building an interfaith coalition to defend the family. We believe the best for children is mothers and fathers who cooperate in a lifelong union of love, surrounded by a culture that supports these aspirations. You can count on the Ruth Institute to know what they're talking about, and you can count on Dr. J to help you put your faith into action and make a difference. This week, we bring you an expert who will help you in your stand for a civilization of love. The Reverend Dr. D. Paul Sullins is a senior research associate for the Ruth Institute. He recently retired as professor of sociology at the Catholic University of America in Washington, D.C. Dr. Sullins is a leader in research on same-sex parenting and its implications for child development. He is the author of 4 books and over 100 journal articles, research reports, and essays on issues of family, faith, and culture. Among many other positions of leadership, he serves on the board of the Center for Family and Human Rights, CFAM, and the Natural Family Journal. And he is a fellow of the Marriage and Religion Research Institute. Dr. Sullins is a former Episcopalian, now a married Catholic priest. And now, for Dr. J's personal interview with Father Paul Sullins.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, and this is the special edition of the Dr. J Show, Making Your New Year's Resolutions with the Ruth Institute. Resolved, this year, we are going to do our part to defend the family, right? Right. And with me today, I have Senior Research Fellow at the Ruth Institute, Father Paul Sullins. Father Sullins, welcome.
Hello, Jennifer. It's so great to be with you and with all of those who will be viewing this video.
Great, great. Thanks so much for joining us. Now, one of the reasons I wanted to include Father Sullins in this special program about making New Year's resolutions is that he has done the most thorough research on clergy sex abuse in the Catholic Church. And this is one of the issues that has been of concern to the Ruth Institute, and I know to many of our followers. Those of you who are not Catholic, I know a lot of your churches have similar problems or related problems. And we certainly have the issues of child sex abuse going on throughout the society. And so we need to get a handle on this. We need to get a grip on this. And I honestly think that nobody but people of faith are likely to get a grip on it, because I just don't see Hollywood pulling themselves together on this issue, or Jeffrey Epstein and his pals. What do you say, Father Sullins? Do you think they're going to get it together?
Well, they would get it together enough to make fun of people of faith and talk about maybe their hypocrisy and to make fun of priests. You know, all of that comes from the seculars who are looking at these issues in the church. But we have a different perspective, a deeper perspective, and also a more transcendent perspective on this problem, which doesn't take away their right to make fun of us. They should. But it tells us that we need to look up when we hear those things.
That's right. That's right. And they're making fun of us, but secretly, I think they kind of know that if we don't get it together, nobody's going to get it together. You know what I mean? So we have a special responsibility here. I would say that to everybody watching this program. So one thing that concerns me as I look around at our followers and friends, I see you on Facebook, I see you in our newsletter, I see you in responding to this video podcast. I know a lot of people are concerned about the runaway sexual revolution, and people are concerned about what's going on inside the church and so on. And rather than just get mad and frustrated, we want to give you something to do, and we want to help you discern what you can be doing that will be constructive. And I promise you, you're going to feel better if you're doing something, rather than just tearing your hair out and, you know, sending mean messages on Facebook or retweeting madly or something like that. You know, a little focus is going to go a long way. So first of all, I'd like to suggest that everybody make a concerted effort as part of your New Year's resolution to pray for the renewal of the family and to pray for the renewal of the culture. And we suggest a few things. This is more or less based on Catholic practice, but it's applicable to anyone. And that is set aside 30 minutes a day. And I know many of you are so busy you won't have 30 uninterrupted minutes. We probably would all like 30 uninterrupted minutes, but that's okay. Do what you can do. So 30 minutes, perhaps one possibility is of scripture, 30 minutes of scripture reading. Another possibility is 30 minutes of meditation. For Catholics, this can include meditating on the life of Christ and Mary through the rosary, or it can include the Stations of the Cross. These are ancient and beautiful approves the things to meditate on, and that are privileged somehow in Catholic understanding. But of course, anyone can do it. And then 30 minutes of adoration before the Blessed Sacrament. Whether exposed or in a tabernacle, that also is privileged. And then, of course, any other thing you want to do for 30 minutes. Now, Father Sullins, you may recognize those four things I mentioned: scripture reading, rosary, Stations of the Cross, adoration. What do those four things have in common?
Those are spiritual works of mercy.
They're spiritual warfare, you know. This is the heavy-hitting stuff, you know. So. Right. So that's why I put that out there for you to consider. But right. I would encourage everyone to come up with something specific that you commit to do every day, you know. And go ahead. Were you going to add to that, Father?
Yeah, I'd be happy to make a couple of suggestions about things times that people can pray. Because I often find that people will tell me, you know, I can't get 30 minutes to pray. And then if I get up earlier, if I try to, you know, pray in a traditional way, that I'm in a room and I'm concentrating on the Blessed Sacrament, or I get interrupted, particularly if I'm in a family.
Yep.
Things, you know, don't often go according to script with a family. And when you have children, I always love it when the families come to church and they come in maybe a little late, and they're, you know, the kids are a little out of sorts and they're trying to get in there. And I say at such moments, God has special grace for families. The more children you have, the more we can tolerate you being late, because I know how difficult it is to get everybody together and in the car and to church. And it's, you know, by the time you get to Mass, you really need to be at Mass, because you need to. So I just think that's part of the beauty and the challenge of family life. So I just want to share a couple of things. What I suggest often to people in families, and particularly mothers, is that they do occasional prayers. The church has a whole great tradition of praying on certain occasions. The best known today is when we sit down to eat. We all say an occasional prayer. That is a prayer that's prompted by a particular occasion. And so praying together as a family, and when you eat, it's amazing how many families have lost that tradition, but it's a great thing. And you're going to find that if you pray together as a family, if you forget that, or if you flub, you know, you're late to do that, your kids will be the first ones to remind you, because they love that tradition. They love to have these these fixed points in their lives. So another time would be when you're getting dressed, or you're dressing the children in the morning, is a great time to say a one-sentence blessing or a prayer. Make the sign of the cross on their forehead and say, may God, or if they have a saint, may Saint Joseph, or whoever it is, be with you today and protect you. Nothing more than that, just short, and it fits into life. Another time I think is great for an occasional prayer is when you're stopped at a traffic signal or at a stop sign, particularly if you're stopping and, you know, the guy coming the other way is cutting you off, or, you know, we can be so out of sorts in a very simple way in traffic. It's a great time to say a Hail Mary or an Our Father or some other prayer, or to pray for the people in the other cars, to do lots of things, to say, Lord, bless that person's family today, or bless the Ruth Institute, if you like, today. It's a great few moments that we can have as a habit, instead of fuming and getting, you know, impatient with the other person or with ourselves. I like praying when I go work out at the gym. It's 40 minutes or so of time that my mind is not particularly focused on what I'm doing. Now, you may have a different experience at the gym. I watch my wife go. She does that Zumba class. I don't think I could pray during Zumba. It's too much concentration. But while I'm working out on the elliptical or the treadmill, I can put on my headphones, and we have wonderful podcasts and apps that bring to us. For myself, I get a morning prayer, part of the Liturgy of the Hours that the priests are called to pray. So I do my breviary while I'm on the treadmill. Mm-hmm. And it's a wonderful time of prayer. I could also do a podcast. I could pray part of the rosary. All of those things could be at another occasion. Also, when you're driving the car, you've got 15, 20 minutes that you're on the highway. It's a great time to be able to pray on that occasion. So I'm just making some practical suggestions, a way that people can integrate prayer into their daily life.
But I need to interrupt you here, because not everybody knows your story. For those of you who are not acquainted with Father Sullins, Father Sullins is a married Catholic priest.
Oh, that, yeah.
Right? And so I don't want people getting freaked out what's going on here. So could you briefly tell how you ended up being married? And honestly, at the Ruth Institute, I didn't plan to have two married priests on my staff, but I have Father Sullins, and then we have Father Mark Hodges, who is an Orthodox priest, and that's part of their tradition. But tell people how you became a married Catholic priest, just briefly, so we don't freak people out.
I wrote a book on married priests.
I know you did.
It's called Keeping the Vow, The Untold Story of Married Catholic Priests, and it's on Amazon. It's Oxford University Press, I think 2015. Of course, it's not a page turner if you promote the family or anything like that, but it does have part of my story, and it has sort of the composite stories just about all the married Catholic priests in the country, and some of their stories are much more exciting than mine. But I grew up as an evangelical Protestant, and when I went to seminary in the late 1970s, I got the experience of going to an Episcopal church, and I was so taken with the liturgy, coming from a kind of Baptist-oriented background, that I became an Episcopalian. And my wife and I got married shortly thereafter, and so we set off as husband and wife in the Episcopal church. The Episcopal church started moving away from a number of its classic traditions and beliefs, started ordaining women, later on started ordaining homosexuals, open homosexual men who had a live-in partner, and homosexual women who had a live-in partner. So that became really difficult for myself and for my wife. And at the same time, we were becoming more and more open to Catholic truth. Partly through our own struggle with having children and the way that God intervened for that, we learned that the Catholic Church had lots of good things to say about the use of contraception, about the use of in vitro fertilization. We discovered natural family planning. And of course, when you discover natural family planning, you find that those classes are populated by lots of very attractive young Catholic couples. And so we made some good friends in the Catholic Church. And to make a long story short, the Lord brought us into the Catholic faith. And so the Catholic Church has a provision for incoming Episcopalian priests to be ordained as Catholic priests after testing and examination. And so that's what happened in my case in 2002.
Tell people who ordained you as a Catholic priest.
Oh, it was then Cardinal Theodore McCarrick.
Yeah.
Today, yeah. Mr. McCarrick.
Mr. McCarrick. Yes, that's right. So how does that feel? I mean, I sound so secular. Tell us how you feel, Father.
Right. Well, I felt, even then, I was ordained in 2002 by Cardinal McCarrick. It's even more poignant than that. And at that time, we were all interviewed. Why do you want to become a priest in the middle of this big sex abuse scandal that was happening in 2002? And we professed our faith in the church and in our leaders. And And all of that has been betrayed. So I feel very betrayed in the past 2 years. In 2018, I was personally offended by my own leaders, Cardinal McCarrick, and then, of course, Cardinal Worrell followed him. It's been difficult in a number of ways for me and for all of us in this Diocese of Washington, D.C. But God has been gracious and brought us lots of mercy in the midst of it all. Yes. But with that experience, I was touched very personally and deeply by the Pennsylvania Grand Jury report, which came out shortly after the discovery of Cardinal McCarrick's misbehavior and sort of its not being addressed right. at all.
Right.
Maybe covered up in some ways. We don't know, really, even today, by the leadership of our church. We are still awaiting the final word from the Vatican or from Pope Francis on what happened. Right. We'd like to know. Even our bishops are kind of banging on the door saying, hey, we want to know what's going on. This is not healthy for us. And then, of course, the testimony, I guess we can call it, of Cardinal Vigano, Archbishop Vigano, all of that put together really kind of awakened me and angered me.
Right.
And so I engaged, as you know, with the good support of the Ruth Institute, on a series of research studies on sex abuse in the Catholic Church. And I looked at an issue that about which there was widespread denial, I believe.
Right.
And that had not really been examined before in any rigorous way. And that is whether or not the sex abuse that the church experienced in great numbers back in the 1980s, the wave of sex abuse back then, was related to having homosexual priests.
Yes. So let's pause right there,
okay?
Because we're going to get into that in some detail, your research and its implications, especially for our viewers and our listeners and the followers of the Ruth Institute.
Right.
The Ruth Institute is proposing for your consideration the following way of thinking about your New Year's resolutions, because that's what we're here to do, is to get you guys, you know, set with something you can do. So I'm proposing three things, okay? And pick one, all right? You can't do everything. You cannot do everything. So you got to be discerning here, and I want you to have that in your mind as I'm talking. Number one, we need to support the victims. And I mean the victims, the direct victims of clergy sex abuse, not me because I feel offended and I'm upset. Yeah, I'm a victim, but that's like nothing. That's nothing in comparison with what the children, the now adult children went through. Okay, so support the victims, number one. Number two, educate people about the full truth of Catholic teaching on marriage, family, and human sexuality. That Catholic truth was at one time the common heritage of all the Christian traditions. If you're Lutheran and you're watching, God love you. You know we're on the same page on this stuff, okay? We got, well, yeah. The things that divide us are, we can set aside for now the things that divide us because we are united on these matters, okay? So educate people about the full truth. And then finally, advocate. Find some kind of advocacy project, and we have a few things to suggest about that too. But as you're thinking, where do I fit in this process? Several considerations. One, do you have the authority to do what you're wanting to do? So I might like to put people in jail. I don't have the authority to put people in jail. I don't have the authority to excommunicate somebody as much as I might like to. I don't have the authority to do certain things, okay? So put that in, you know, that's part of the mix of discerning what to do. Do you have the competence to do it? I don't have the competence to judge guilt or innocence. For an individual case, I don't do individual, I don't do investigative journalism and so on. What we have competence to do here at the Ruth Institute is analyze data. And that brings us to the third thing. Do you enjoy doing it? Do you have an inclination to do it? And as you'll see, Father Sullins and I get a buzz out of charts. And so therefore, this is our contribution, okay? But your contribution may be different, and I hope that you'll get some ideas about what you can do this year to help these grave problems within the church and the world. So, Father Sullins, let's now talk a little bit about the victims of clergy sex abuse, what we know about them. And you've done now two reports for the Ruth Institute, one that came out in November of 2018 that focused on homosexual priests and that whole issue. And secondly, the second one came out in June of 2019, and that focused on how things have changed since in the last 10 or 15 years, because you've got more updated data. So let's tell people, what do we know about the victims of clergy sexual abuse in the Catholic Church?
Right. The most important thing to know is that in the 1980s, over 90% of the victims were boys, young boys. We use the word prepubescent. So these are boys who are younger than 13 years old or so. And today, in the last 3 to 5 years, it has been the opposite. Most of the victims have been girls. Not quite as high a percent, but well over half of the victims have been girls. And so that is a sea change in the nature of victimization in the abuse of children in the Catholic Church.
The 90% male victims.
Somewhere between 3 to 5% of those victims were under the age of 8.
Okay.
And so those would be called victims of pedophilia or child sex abuse. It's often talked about in popular depictions as a wave of child sex abuse or pedophile priests, but that's false. Only a very small proportion would classify by any definition as pedophilia. Most of the abuse was some form of predation of older men attempting to have sex relations or to be sexually excited in various ways by younger men. Paederasty would be the most widespread term for that. And so what we have seen by any objective look is a wave of homosexual predation of younger boys in the 1980s. And that was an explosion or a wave during that era. That has dropped off fairly rapidly into the 90s and up to the present age. We don't have much of that going on today that I can find. But during that time, we also had the abuse or predation of girls, which occurred at a fairly constant rate from the 1980s to today. So what has happened today is that the abuse of boys has dropped dramatically. The abuse of girls has not dropped and, in fact, has risen slightly in the last decade or so. And so we have more sex abuse of minors that happens in the church today than we had a decade ago. But we have a whole lot less than we had in the 1980s.
Okay.
So the picture is a little more complex when you hear some folks say, well, child sex abuse is a thing of the past in the Catholic Church. It's not a problem today. Well, half of that is true. It is a thing of the past if we're talking about the abuse of boys at a very, very high rate or comparatively high rate. That is a thing of the past, pretty much. But there is abuse that's going on. It's mostly abuse of young girls today. And the abuse is overall is rising somewhat due to a growing complacency, really, by bishops and diocesan leaders with regard to the standards and the criteria that were put in place in 2002 in the Charter for the Protection of Children and Youth to protect young people in the Catholic Church.
So this is consistent, the chart in your second sex abuse report.
Right.
Figure 14 shows this very dramatic spike. I'd like you to say just a few words about reporting, Father, because this is a question we often hear from people. There's always under-reporting, So tell me this. Who is more likely to report, boys or girls? Do we know that, number one? And number two, how long does it typically take people to report their abuse experiences?
Yeah. girls are far more likely to report having been abused than boys are. One thing we have to keep in mind is that somewhere between 80 and 90% of all sex abuse, either of boys or girls, is perpetrated by males. It is very rare for an adult female to try to abuse a younger male or female. It happens, but it's a minor factor. And of course, in the Catholic Church, where you have all male clergy, pretty much all the perpetrators are males. And so if a girl has been abused by a male, she's much more likely to report that. A boy, for reasons you might think about, if he's been abused by a male, an older male, he tends not to want to report that. Almost all sex abuse victims at some point feel that it was their fault or partly
their
fault.
Yes, and let's pause right on that point, because a lot of times one of the premises of the sexual revolution is this: if we would just all get over our hang-ups and stop stigmatizing certain behaviors, everybody would be fine with it. The kids would be fine with it. It's just the adults freaking out. That's what makes them upset. I have now talked to numerous people, male and female, who are survivors of sexual abuse. Yeah. Not a single one of them reports feeling that way. They all will tell you they knew from the beginning it was wrong. It felt wrong. It was wrong from the beginning. So very important to see. And I've talked to people one person who's literally molested in the cradle by a relative. So people know. People know it's wrong, right? And so your males versus females reporting, we know that. That's not just in Catholic data. That's what people know about sex abuse across the board, isn't it?
Across the board, even in the Me Too movement in Hollywood and all of that, it's amazing that women, mostly, are coming out and protesting against this behavior of being taken advantage of and abused by men. In ways that if what had happened was part of one of the movies that they produced, it would be seen as a good plot point put forth. So they produce these movies that want to just kind of celebrate and normalize this behavior in a lot of ways. But when it actually happens, lots of women stand up and say, no, this is not acceptable. Men acting like animals and thinking that they can just take advantage of their positions of power, in order to do things with my body that I don't assent to, that's just wrong.
Right.
And it's really amazing when they say that, because I want to say, well, why is it wrong? What is it when in the very movie that you're producing, often you don't show it as wrong. What you're saying is, it's dimly, they're kind of stumbling toward this recognition that when you touch somebody's body in an intimate way, you are touching something sacred.
Right.
You are touching part of their spirit created by God.
Right.
And the only place I know where that's said in that way is in the Bible, in the Holy Scriptures.
Right.
Where it says that we are made male and female in the image of God. And it doesn't mean male and female as concepts. It means male and female as bodies, that our bodies are made to reflect the image of God. And when you touch my body, you are touching my spirit, and you are dealing with very, very profound, sacred matter.
Yes, yes. And the secular take on this is that they have wanted consent to do all the work of saying of dividing acceptable from unacceptable sex. And I think that's going away. And so Ruth Institute followers, be aware that the Me Too movement and all of that stuff, as confused as it is, it has a potential to help people see that there's more at stake here than consent. Consent is so lame, that's such a lame, weak read to use. Right. It's necessary, but not sufficient. Certainly not sufficient. So what I want to say to people, though, about supporting the victims. Okay, so Father's given you a little bit of insight into the victims, what we know about them, what we don't know about them, and so on. But supporting the victims, I think it's very important that first of all, is an issue of justice. They deserve to be supported by us, right? And second of all, I think that to solve these problems, there are multiple steps that have to be handled. So you've got law enforcement, and you've got church authorities and civil authorities, and you've got the pilots who flew Jeffrey Epstein's airplanes, and, you know, all kind of people who are kind of involved here. And I think the more visible the victim, the more the victim is a real person, the more likely all those people are to do the right thing. And as an example of that, I give you the Diocese of Buffalo. Siobhan O'Connor was the secretary to Bishop Malone, and she liked him. She cared about him. But the victims that she was talking to and whose files she was seeing, they became real people to her. And Siobhan O'Connor couldn't take it anymore, and she walked out of there. She became a whistleblower, and everything that's happened in Buffalo has happened because she saw the victim as a real person. So some of you may have as your special calling and your special vocation to be present as in friendship and support for people you know who've been victimized in various ways. And there are a lot of ways to do that. That's where your discernment comes in. But, you know, maybe you've got somebody in your past that you kind of blew off, you know, that you kind of said, this is uncomfortable. I don't really want to hear about it. And you can go back to that person and maybe reach out to that person. So
you've touched on a point that it brings up something that's in a way even worse than the sex abuse that's occurred. As horrific as that is, it happened not in a school context or not in a sports context, but it happened in the context of faith. Mm-hmm. And so when a victim was touched and was traumatized, it was a traumatization that affected that person's relationship with God, made it more difficult for that person to know and to understand and to trust God. We in the Catholic faith believe that our relationship with God is mediated through the church, through the sacraments. And when we lose faith in this church and in the sacraments, it affects us very, very deeply. And I have to say that I've been very privileged and a little not quite sure how to address the fact that I have been contacted by a number of victims and a number of other people who work with victims because of my research. And they think I know what to do or how to address some of these things. And I really don't, but I try to find out something more than I know so that I can help them a little bit. And in doing that, I have heard from other victim coordinators and people who work with victims around the country from other dioceses. And a number of them are frustrated that the bishops that they are working for are not as responsive and not as caring for the victims as they would like them to be. Mm-hmm. We have so many bishops that see the victims as a liability to be managed.
Right.
So they want to have the appearance of being helpful to the victims, but not there's not a lot of energy in doing that. I'm not saying that they are hard-hearted in themselves, but they are concerned more with keeping things on an even keel in the church and not interrupting some other ministries in the church and see the victims as maybe a threat to that.
Right.
So actually, in sociology, we have this trend that we talk about called blaming the victim, where the very person who has been victimized by something becomes the one that the community turns on, tries to hurt even further.
Right.
And I see that happening in the Catholic Church. And in a way, it victimizes all of us. Everybody puts money in the plate.
Right. No kidding. No kidding.
It really harms all of us to do that.
And so, it re-traumatizes the victim.
Yes.
You know, the original victim is re-traumatized. And I have heard from people who can't go to Mass anymore, who can't go into the church anymore. And I would love to know how to be helpful to them, you know, what we as lay Catholics or as clergy or whatever, what we can do to help that person. And some of you are going to be really good at this step, okay? I know that there's somebody among the people who are going to watch this video, there's somebody who's going to be good at this and who's going to figure it out. We also, in earlier editions of the Dr. J Show, I have interviewed victims of clergy sex abuse. So if you go back to some of the very first interviews we did, one was with Alan Hebert, who was a male victim of clergy sex abuse, who talked about his experience in the book he wrote. And then also we interviewed Dr. Deborah Rodriguez, who is herself a victim and who is also a therapist. And she actually does know what to do, unlike you and me, Mr. Nerds. You know, we don't know what to do, but there are people who do. So over the course of this year, we're going to be interviewing more and more people like that who can help make your parish a trauma-informed ministry so that you do a better job of it. Okay, and so that could be your unique calling in a way of supporting the victims. Okay, so let's now look at the question of educating people, of educating the whole church, because I think a crucial aspect of this whole thing has been the collapse of catechesis around proper conduct. Pope Benedict himself said this, that the rise of the sexual revolution kind of polluted the way in which people were trained in the seminary, and then people became, because of their own guilty consciences perhaps, became less willing to speak the whole truth. So what can we as lay people, or perhaps ordinary clergy, you're responsible for your parish, you're not responsible for the whole diocese, I'm responsible for my home and my neighborhood and things like that. What can ordinary people do to educate themselves and those around them about the church's full teaching, the full understanding of the importance of the human body and human sexuality? What would you suggest to people, Father Sullins, that they could do in that regard?
Yeah, the fundamental thing that people have to do is to recognize and refuse the misinformation.
Mm-hmm.
It's so rampant in almost every source from our culture today about sex and about the sexual revolution. We can't emphasize this enough. I don't want to call it a campaign of lies, because I don't want to stigmatize anybody, but it is a rampant falsehood about what it means to be sexual beings and about how we should behave toward one another sexually. Actually, one of the best statements of this repeatedly comes from our Holy Father, Pope Francis, when asked about gender ideology. His number one response is, it is a lie of the devil. And he emphasizes this again and again. It's a plot of the devil to destroy the family. I would recommend people getting his book and reading his latest book, which is called Rebuking the Devil. Because when Francis talks about a lie of the devil, he's not talking about some abstract concept. He is talking about a real devil. In fact, one thing that people could do, if we have a New Year's resolution, is that if your church does not say the St. Michael prayer following Mass, you could start that and start encouraging a group of people to do that. And you have no better authority to do that than Pope Francis, because he has called for all Catholic churches to reinstate reciting the St. Michael prayer after Mass like they used to do before Vatican II.
That's a very important point. You know, another thing that we can talk about is the theology of the body. Now, a lot of Catholics are familiar with it. Not everybody's familiar with it. Non-Catholics should be familiar with it, because it's some very powerful stuff. And it was written by Pope John Paul II. And it was disseminated by him and explained by him over a period of several years. And it's really, in one sense of the word, it's the same old, because he comes to the same conclusion. So there's certain things you got to do and certain things you can't do. You know, so there's no change in any of that. But the way in which he presents it is profoundly scriptural and profoundly humane, I would say, and very philosophical. It's very dense philosophically, so I don't necessarily recommend you pick up the book and read it yourself. But there are people who are explaining it and breaking it down and making it useful and creating programs that can be used in schools and catechetical programs and things like that. So do you have any experience with that, with any of that material, Father Sullins?
I wish I had more. I think that one good place for anyone to start on this issue or any issue is with the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And it is very clear on all of the issues of the sexual revolution. They're not gathered together in one section. But if you look at the section on marriage, you find most of what it's teaching right there. The great thing about, there it is, about using the catechism is that it's authoritative.
Right.
You can take anything that it says, you can take it to the bank.
Right.
You know that it will bless you and bless your life to read that and to follow it.
And in fact, I think this is something for our non-Catholic brothers and sisters as well. Okay, I'm just going to state here there are several places that are relevant to the work of the Ruth Institute. One is in this part about the sacraments. There's a whole thing on the sacrament of matrimony. So that's definitely relevant. And then there's the material on the Ten Commandments. There's a whole section on the Ten Commandments. Honor your father and your mother has material about that's germane to the sexual revolution.
Sure.
Thou shalt not kill covers all of the life issues.
Yes.
And then thou shalt not commit adultery. Okay, those three, that material, the Ruth Institute, we are not a Catholic outfit in the sense that we're an interfaith coalition to defend the family. But everything that comes out of the Ruth Institute is going to be consistent with that part of the catechism. So those of you who are non-Catholic who wonder what the heck is going on over at the Ruth Institute, pick this up. If you read those sections, you'll see that that's what we're about. And so if you can in good conscience be part of what we're doing on that, of course, we want you to be part of what we're doing, you know, and you know, sure. If you're worried about papal primacy or indulgences or anything like that, don't worry about it, you know, just hang out with us, work on this together, we'll
sure.
get something done, we'll get something done. And you'll see that we don't have horns and we don't worship statues and stuff like that. It's really okay. So that's important. You know, another program that we're starting at the Ruth Institute, Father, something we're calling the cloud of witnesses, okay? Mm-hmm. Which comes from that beautiful passage in Hebrews, okay? But what we mean by the cloud of witnesses are the people who can testify that the church's teaching is sound and what the sexual revolution is teaching is not sound.
Yeah.
So
sure.
In response to Father James Martin, in response to Pastor Josh Harris and people of that kind, we present Mr. Hudson Biblow. We present Mr. Doug Mainwaring. We present people who lived in accordance with the creed of the LGBT lifestyle and who no longer do, right? And who now have found a better way and who believe better and who live better. And we want you to hear what they have to say. So here's a project for you. Here's something for you to think about, Ruth Institute followers. Anytime somebody... Father James Martin shows up in your Twitter feed, for example, okay? But this can be a stand-in for, obviously, for a lot of other similar irritations. Instead of just getting so mad, why doesn't the Pope shut him up? Or whatever, you know, which
right.
obviously you can't control that part. But what you can do is every time somebody puts up Father James Martin, you bring up, oh, you know, here's another view.
Mm-hmm.
Here's you should listen to this talk by Hudson Biblow. He really has something different to say, you know, and by doing that, you're taking away some of the weight of the false teaching and countering it with the true and clear teaching. Because at the end of the day, that's what people need. They need to know, they don't just need a point-by-point refutation of people who are in error. You need to see the full presentation of what the good life is actually like. So that's one of the things we're putting together. And by the time you see this podcast, it'll be in place, you know, that you can cite those people and even bring them in for a talk. So
I think it would be a tonic for our whole culture for people in love and respect to present a different point of view and not to be focused so much on denouncing or vilifying the people on the other side of the issue.
Right.
We tend to be very polarized today in the United States against with people who are on two sides of a fence throwing rocks at each other. And it's really great for some of those folk to climb the fence and try to talk reasonably and present something different to the other side.
Right.
You may get a rock thrown at you when you do that, but
right.
you are really carrying forward the gospel just to present in love and in faith. The truth that you know it, because the truth is what's going to be liberating.
That's right. And if you really believe that, yes, then this is the thing to do with it, you know. So
right.
I just want to report on something we did that was a kind of a success that happened with the Ruth Institute.
Right.
I had some friends online who were complaining about Father James Martin coming to their town. And I proposed this. I said, well, why don't you bring in somebody to counter him? And somebody raised their hand and said, okay, you're on, you know. So we got it together and we brought Hudson Biblo to speak in Rochester, New York. And he came and he gave a great talk and he inspired, you know, probably 250 people while he was there. And in the process, the people who were arranging his talk, and we were in the background helping a little bit at the Ruth Institute, and we would help you too if you chose to do this, listeners, okay? But it has to be somebody locally carrying the, you know, doing the bulk of the work, because we can't do that from Louisiana. That doesn't make any sense to try to do that. But the people there locally in Rochester had to respectfully go to their bishop and say, is it okay to do this on church property? Is it okay to advertise in the church, in diocesan publications and so on? And so they respectfully presented the whole, presented the alternative view within all those various organs of Catholic life there. And the bishop, of course, was fine with it, you know, and so therefore it went forward and it was held in a church, you know, a church facility and so on. And none of that would have happened if those people hadn't taken the initiative to make it happen. And by the way, Hudson's speech is online, available at the Ruth Institute podcast page, if you'd like to see it for yourself and see what he has to say. And that can be one of the things that you share. So all of this is by way of educating people about the truth of Catholic teaching, the authentic version here. So we got support the victims. We got educate people.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about advocacy. Mm. Some people want to be advocates. Some people want to be, you know, kind of mixing it up. Some people like to see the ball moving forward. Some people aren't afraid of confrontation, kind of enjoy it. There's certain kind of temperament here that this may be more your cup of tea than having coffee with somebody who's suffering. You know, there's something for everyone. That's what I'm getting at. So things you could do to advocate that would be helpful in overcoming the sexual revolution, including the clergy sex abuse, is you can sign petitions. We almost always have petitions going.
Right.
You can get to work at your local school. Okay. One of the big problems is bad sex ed in the public schools and even in the Catholic schools.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So you can take responsibility for your school and your location. You don't have the power to change it all, but you certainly have every right and authority to say, I'm part of this parish, I'm part of this county, I have something to say about this.
Mm-hmm.
And with discernment and education, you know, you don't want to just go in and make noise, you know, you want to be prepared and so on. But some of you can do that, should do that, are going to be really good at doing that. And I know there already are people engaged in that type of activity in various ways. So I want to put that in your mind. That is how you can help move the ball forward in this area.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, the drag queen story hours have brought a lot of people out. That has pushed people over the edge. It's like, no, we cannot have this in our local public library.
Right.
And as a result of that, people are becoming more aware of what's been going on in the public schools all along. And in some cases, even what's going on in the Catholic schools.
Mm-hmm.
So, you have every right and authority and responsibility to get involved at that level. So any other advocacy projects that you can think of, Father, things that people could do that would be helpful to, you know, in terms of interacting with authority figures or the public? Anything come to mind?
A couple of things. This might not fit right exactly in this category, but it is certainly interacting with an authority figure. But when we're talking about the victims, one of the things that we can do is to make reparations. And that's extremely powerful. So that the important thing for a victim, of course, first is to listen to that person.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody wants to hear. And to just listen and kind of validate that person in their pain and in their trouble. And then to say, I'm going to make reparations for you. I I believe that God spiritually can put grace in your life, and that I can try to take on some of the suffering that you've endured, and we can do that. When you say the St. Michael prayer at the end of Mass, you can do that with an intention to make reparation for a particular victim. You can also, in the round of the prayers that you can do those in an intercessory way, and that's very, very powerful. But with regard to advocacy particularly, I think it's really important for people to speak up.
Mm-hmm.
Too many people of faith think that faith is something private and personal, and I don't want to put that out there in the civic culture and cause trouble to anyone. But it's really important for parents and schools to go to those meetings, and even if they give you a couple of minutes and no more, to use that and to speak up. Because the more people that speak up, the more the truth is heard, and the more in this country we have the democratic traditions, the more we will be able to change the culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's really important. You know, another thing I sometimes hear from victims is walking by a school building or an auditorium that is named after somebody who was a predator. And so right now we don't know who all's done what. And so I think it would be a good policy to stop naming buildings after clergy, you know, and just name buildings after canonized saints or after virtues, or, you know, this is the Hope Academy or the Hope Auditorium or, you know, something. Just get that out of there, because now people are used to seeing Monsignor Smith's name on the building,
right?
And to take it off is a big deal. You know, it would be a big deal to take it off. But if you just had a policy, you know what, we're not going to name stuff.
Yeah.
You know, here's how we're going to name stuff in this diocese.
Right.
Bang. And that's something that I think you could make a sensible campaign of advocacy for. You know, again, you don't want to go in and just stomp your foot about it. But you can, I think, make some progress by just bringing that up as a point. You had a reaction to that, Father. Go ahead.
Yes, our new bishop, Wilton Gregory in the Archdiocese of Washington, just established this policy.
Is that so?
Said going forward, no building or other place in this diocese will be named after anyone unless that person is on the roster of saints. And so I think that's very sensible. If you think about it, it was never appropriate to name Catholic projects after the name of some priest or bishop or some other big donor, kind of copying the status acquisition of the world. We should honor those that the church has honored for their faith and for their sacrifice. So I think it makes a lot of sense, and certainly it's not going to bring pain to those victims.
Right.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that Archbishop Gregory
He has just done that. Now, I'm imagining that he didn't come up with that idea all by himself, that someone mm-hmm. advocated that, suggested that to him. And that's a great thing that people can do to their own bishop.
Right.
And it's not a particularly controversial item, or it shouldn't be. If your bishop says, well, gee, I object because then they're not going to name a stadium after me or something like that, well, then that tells you something about your
right.
bishop.
Right.
It'd be good to know anyway.
Right.
But most bishops are going to be humble enough to say, yeah, you know, that might make sense. And particularly if you can say, you know, here are some victims who feel traumatized. Here are the letters telling how they're traumatized because the auditorium in this parish hall is named after this priest that, you know, that abused them years ago or something like that.
Right.
I think that you can make a good case for changing some of those names.
Right.
Saying,
right.
Well, how about, you know, we retire this name and put in the name of a saint here.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And no. Yeah. Well, that's great. So to wrap up our time together, I just want to say to all of our listeners and viewers, thank you so much for being with us. Here at the Ruth Institute, we have a whole variety of things that can help you whatever you choose to do, whatever your New Year's resolution may be, we hope that you're going to pray in a systematic way. And if you want to support the victims, if you want to educate the public, if you want to advocate for sensible policies, we have materials that can help you. Earlier editions of the Dr. J Show and episodes of the Dr. J Show going forward, we have this material available for you. We are covering all of these points. We have books for sale in the Ruth Institute store that are very helpful. We've got a real nice collection of this type of material. And our weekly newsletter, which you should really think about subscribing to our weekly newsletter, because, you know, we might get deplatformed by Mark Zuckerberg or whoever it is that owns YouTube today or whatever. That could happen to us at the Ruth Institute. It wouldn't be unheard of. But if you're on our email list, they can't stop us. They can't stop us from talking to you by email. So all of those ways are ways that the Ruth Institute is here to help you become an advocate and a defender of the family. So Father Paul Sullins, thank you so much for being with me. And thank you to all of our viewers. Have a wonderful new year, 2020, and make those resolutions and stick to them.
Amen.
Amen.
Been watching Dr. J's personal interview with the Reverend Dr. D. Paul Sullins. Deanne Miller on AdvocateWeb.org writes, "Clergy sexual abuse can poison all that is traditionally held precious about the church. Symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder can surface whenever a survivor encounters any church leader, spiritual symbol, ritual, hymn, prayer, religious writing, even the sight of a church building. Survivors need pastoral care for spiritual healing." And now for the most important part of our program, your action item for this week. Our most important weapon is prayer. Intercede for the victims and intercede for our culture. Support the victims. Listen to the person. Validate him or her in their pain. Educate people. Speak up to challenge misinformation about how great the sexual revolution of the 60s and onward is. Advocate for sensible policies. Sign petitions. Take responsibility locally, at your school, at your local library. Go to meetings and speak up. Avail yourself of the many resources at the Ruth Institute. Dr. J Show podcasts, books, and other resources for healing. Sign up for the Ruth Institute weekly newsletter. And that's our action item for this week.
Praise God. Amen. You may be seated.
Father Sullins, tell us about the virtue of hope and the making of New Year's resolutions.
Sure. I think one of the worst consequences of the clergy sex abuse crisis today in the Catholic Church is that so many people have lost hope that God can recover and restore the church. They look at all these victims. They look at priests' misbehavior. They look at bishops that are not necessarily doing what they should be doing, and they just kind of give up. And one of the wonderful things about a new year, a New Year's resolution, is that it's a time of new beginning. People have this sense that the past is gone and the future lies before us as a clean slate. It's page one, chapter one of what is to come. And so it's a wonderful gift to us to encourage and lift up our hope as we apply that sense to what God has in his mind, I'm convinced, to do hopefully and wonderfully in our church in the future.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.